When we see the classification of fibers, we see there are natural and synthetic fibers, and under the natural fibers we have cellulosic and the protein fibers. And today we are going to study about the wool fiber, which is one of the protein fiber. It is naturally crimped fiber that is available, and this is one of the fiber that is being taken from the sheep, whereas the other natural fiber, the protein fiber silk, is extruded fiber. When we take the protein fibers in general, they all have the elements like hydrogen, nitrogen and oxygen, but especially wool has another element called as sulfur. And wool is not a new fiber, and it has been there since ages. And when we see the old prehistoric times, we see that man has used the wool fiber to cover his body, and from then on he knew about the spinning of wool and making it into a fabric. It was during the time of Babylonians where they started breeding animals for both for the meat purpose as well as for the fiber purpose. And it was during the time of the Romans who thought that there should be a specialized breeding meant for the fiber alone. And during the Middle Ages, when we see, we can see that it has spread to the other parts of the Europe. So when we take about the Industrial Revolution, where it has taken place, so from that time onwards, wool from the home front has gone into the industrial situation, where the industry has grown up to a very greater extent. And we see that wool fibers are the ones that are mostly sought after as a luxurious fiber apart from silk alone. So when we see that the countries producing wool fiber, we see majorly the Australia producing about 1/4 of the total production of wool that is required by the world, whereas the other countries are China and New Zealand. So all these three countries stand the first three in rating, whereas our India stands alone in the 10th position. So the type of wool that is obtained from any of the sheep already be based on the type of nutrition it receives, the climatic conditions it goes, as well as the breed type or the genetic type of the breed. And when we take about the different types of wools, so when we take the basic classification, we see that there are two types. One is based on the fleece and one is based on the breed also. Now when we take the classification based on the fleece from where it has been taken, we see that there are different classes. Like the first variety is supposed to be called as the lamb's wool. So lamb's wool is that which is been shorn from the animal for the first time when the lamb is around 6 to 8 months of age. So because the hair is removed for the first time, you can see the tip of the hair in this particular fiber. It is smooth, it is very soft, and we can see the taper end for this particular fiber. And because of this softness and the smoothness, it is mainly used in the children's clothing. And then next variety is the hogget wool. This particular wool is also shown for the first time, but from an animal which is around 12 to 14 months old. So similar to the lamb's wool, we also have here a tapered end. The fiber is very smooth, but in fact it is stronger than the lamb's wool because the animal has aged and matured enough. And that is the reason why, because of its strength, this is mostly used in the warp yarns when the fabric is being woven. So the next one is the wether wool, where we can see that it lacks softness, but it contains a lot of dirt and soil in it. And the next wool variety is the pulled wool, where the animals, after they have been slaughtered for the meat, wool also can be taken or collected from these fleece. And for this they use some chemical methods where the it's easier for the hair to be removed from it, and because of that the follicles get disturbed, and the variety of wool we get from this particular type of pulled wool is a very inferior quality. And next is the dead wool, because sometimes the sheep, when they are on the range, they would die and meet with some accident. So from such animals, when wool is collected, we call it as a dead wool. And this wool is supposed to be of a very inferior grade, and it can be used for only fabrics which are of low grade fabric. And the next variety of wool is the cotty wool, where it is similar to that of a cotton, and because it is brittle, hard. This happens because the animals are malnourished and proper weather conditions were not existing for them, and so we get a very wool that is resembling cotton, and that's the reason why the name is given to this particular wool. And we have the other variety called as a tags wool, where the broken parts, the cut parts and all these pleats are being used, and discolored ones are also used in this, and so wool is taken from this. So it is supposed to be an inferior quality, even like that of the other wools. Now when we take the animal as such and then consider the types of wools that are available on the animal, we have different varieties of wools that can be taken. Generally from the belly, from the neck, we generally get a wool which is of inferior quality, whereas the wool that is taken from the sides and shoulders is supposed to be the best quality wool and a fine grade wool. When we take wool from one particular animal, we call it as a fleece, and when we take wool from different animals or many animals at a time, we call it also as a clip. Now when we go for the processing, depending upon the varieties or the classification which I have told just now, the animals are shorn or the hair is removed during the season of spring or just before the onset of the summer. It can be the mechanical process as well as the manual process. So in the manual process, men use shears to remove the hair, as well as in the mechanical process, we have a mechanized shear which helps in removing the wool in one particular piece. So the complete wool is taken as a one piece. And this wool is also called as greased wool because it contains the content of grease in it. And it's such a laborious process and it takes a lot of time. So scientists have come up with a new variety of shearing the animal called as a bioclip. So in this bioclip, the animal is injected with a protein, wherein this protein will help the animal to shed the wool as it is, that is without shearing by the people or manually or by the machines as well. This is supposed to be accepted everywhere because there may be some damages that would happen to the skin of the animals when shearing is done mechanically. So on an average, we can see that around 3 to 8 kgs of fleece is taken from one particular sheep. After the shearing is done, the next process would be the sorting and grading, where skilled workers are required for the sorting and grading because they have to be sorted on varieties of type, length, fineness and elasticity and also the strength. While sorting, they also sort it about the types of colors because the colors are available from the BG to light shades of yellowish to brown and even black. And apart from that, even fibers are sorted here based on the length also, because generally in sorting out wool, we have two varieties where there is a woolen yarn and a worsted yarn that can be made from the same fibers. Generally, the woolen yarn goes for the ordinary apparel, whereas the worsted yarn is supposed to be a higher or a superior quality, which would generally go for the dressing wear. So generally, less than 3 inches go for making a lightweight thing, and more than 4 inches are generally used for making the worsted yarn. Once the sorting is done, then they are baled up and then they go for the next processing called as garneting process. In the garneting process, what happens is sometimes used and unused wool materials are undergoing a process wherein they are brought, they are shredded and then made into a fibrous form in the garneting process. And they are also given a carbonizing treatment to remove any vegetable matter present in it. So the final mass would depend upon what the stock material is, and also sometimes the final fiber that we get out of garneting is 5 times costlier even than a natural wool fiber. This is because the processing that it undergoes and the cleaning process being done for it. The next process, scouring process. Scouring is generally a process which is intended to clean the fiber. It is collected from the animals. You find a lot of dirt, grease, dust and sweat of the animal, which has to be completely removed from the fiber before it is being processed into a yarn. So in this process, we see that the raw wool is scoured using it with a mild solution of soap and an alkali otherwise in a series of baths. It's not just one single bath. So series of baths, where slowly the amount of grease is being removed. We can see around 30 to 70% of the grease present in the wool, and so that has to be removed here, and the dirt has to be removed. These machines generally have some rakes which will turn the wool in the solution, and also they have a pair of squeezers where after washing in the solution, it goes between the squeezers where the wool is squeezed during the process. So, the grease that is taken out from this fiber is supposed to be called as lanolin. This is after purification, it is one of the products that can be used in the cosmetics and soaps and also some other household products also. So, after the scouring process, if the wool is not completely cleared of the vegetable matter or any other dirt, then it undergoes another process called as the carbonization process, wherein in the carbonization, wool is treated with either a dilute solution of hydrochloric acid or sulfuric acid at 5 to 7 by weight, around 65% of wet pickup. Once the fiber is treated with these dilute solutions, then it is dried for some time at around 65 to 90 degrees centigrade to concentrate the solution, and then after that it is put into a baking oven where it is baked for 125 degrees centigrade for 1 minute. So, by baking this, the vegetable matter which is present in the wool gets charred because of the sulfuric acid or the hydrochloric acid, and this becomes very brittle, and this brittled material can be easily removed because it is a crushable material that is formed, and then this material after treating in carbonizing process is passed through the rollers where the vegetable matter that has been charred brittle enough passing through this particular machine. And then after this there is another process called the neutralization, because we have treated the fiber with acid, it cannot be left alone without neutralization, otherwise the fiber on storage would lead to lot many problems. So, for that neutralization has to be done, and after neutralization then the fibers that are taken out from this particular end of the process are supposed to be called as extracts. Then the next process after treating it, we have to dry the particular wool that has been undergone the carbonization process. So, this is carried out in such a way that around 12 to 16% of moisture is still present in the fiber. If completely the fiber is bone dry, then it would be a problem in the spinning process, and so to handle the fibers, this process of drying is restricted so that around 16% of moisture is present in the wool. The next process is oiling, where this is a lubrication process because we have removed a lanolin material in the scouring process and it is very impossible to spin the fiber. So, under these conditions, oiling is done to the fiber using either mineral oil or animal oil or even the vegetable oil. So, this makes the fiber very smooth and it becomes very easy in the spinning operation. After giving oiling treatment, the fiber would be dyed, because wool is generally dyed in the fiber stage itself. Dyeing the fiber in the fiber stage, there are lot advantages wherein the colors of the fiber or the dye would be very deep, and at the same time the color fastness is something excellent in terms of making a fiber dyed fabric. So, for this generally if it is to be dyed, then the fibers are dyed and then it goes for the spinning process. The next process is blending. There are sometimes wherein they try to bring down, because as we have seen the varieties of wool, we see that there are some costly wools and there are some rough varieties and smoother varieties. So, when we use alone the rough varieties or smoother varieties, the cost of the fabric would be differing. So, to bring down the cost of the fabric, which is very high, to a normal level, sometimes the raw wool or the wool that is of low quality sometimes is mixed up or blended up with the fiber. And not only that, blending is a process wherein we can bring about lot many changes, wherein good qualities of one particular fiber and the good qualities of a second fiber can be combined together to get a fabric of maybe 90 to 100% of good qualities. So, in this process sometimes wool is also blended with polyester, because polyester is supposed to be having a capacity to blend with any fiber. So, by then what happens is certain fabrics which are not meant for tropical regions. So, in such cases, they blend the fibers so that the fabric can be utilized in a tropical region. So, blending has to be done here. After blending, the wool that is meant for making woolen yarn would generally go to the spinning, whereas the wool that is meant for the worsted, that is a finer quality of wool, that goes few more steps of processing like the carding. So, in the carding, like that of the carding of cotton, here it is a process wherein the longer fibers are taken into consideration and the smaller fibers, or we call them as noils, are completely combed out of this fiber, so that the longer fibers will be available in the yarn, which will be giving when the short fibers are present in the yarn, there is a fuzzy appearance that is seen on the surface. So, such things would give a problem in the usage. So, generally for high quality fabrics, the worsted yarn is used. So, this process will generally divide into these two classes of worsted and woolen yarns. So, in the next process called as the gilling and combing, it is further straightening of the fibers, further removal of the short fibers, where after removing them, the totally finer, longer fibers remain, so that they would go for the spinning process into the worsted yarn. So, here after making them, they are made or wound onto tops, and then they go another process of drawing, where drafting, twisting, winding of stock, and the sliver is made into a very compact, and then it is made into a very thin slubber. So, just before spinning, we have another process called as roving, where in the roving, a light twisting operation is given to the slubber, which is already done in the previous step, and the linear weight of the sliver is significantly reduced. So, we get a very, very fine quality or a very thin yarn called as a roving. Then we have the spinning operation, where in the spinning operation, the roving is again drawn out, it is twisted, it is attenuated, and sometimes when we see the woolen yarn is spun on the mule spinning, whereas the worsted yarn can be done on the mule, ring, flyer, or even in the cap. So, sometimes to insert the twist, sometimes oiling is done. If you want a higher twist, oiling has to be done to the yarn here also, so that it can hold the twist, or if low twist is required, generally sliver is not given any oiling there. When we see the differences between the worsted yarn and the woolen yarn, we can see that in the woolen yarn, short staple fiber, which are carded only and which had a very slack twist and which are weaker, which are bulkier, a very soft twisted ones are only used for the woolen yarns. Whereas for the worsted yarns, we can see that the combed yarns, the carded and the combed, which makes them very proper alignment and very parallel and long fibers with a highly twisted one. And because of naturally they are longer and highly twisted, we can see them to be very stronger, and they are fine, smoother also, and hard twist also can be given to them. So, these are the basic differences between the woolen and the worsted yarns. So, when we see about the weaving, we can see the woolen yarn, as I have told you earlier, it is generally done in the plain weave, and sometimes only it is done in the twill weave. And this generally is desirable for sportswear, jackets, sweaters, blankets, and things apparel for general use. And sometimes these fabrics are also nabbed enough to give a fluffy appearance and for the warmth, in fact. And when we see the worsted yarns, they are meant basically for twill weave, and all the dressy purposes, tailored ones, and suits and coats, this particular worsted yarn is used there. Now, there is a Wool Products Labeling Act. As I was telling you earlier, that fibers can be blended to bring down the cost of it and also give additional features to the particular fabric. But in terms of a consumer, this is very undesirable, because the consumer must be aware of what has been mixed up and to what extent it has been mixed up. So, to make the consumers aware, there was a Wool Products Labeling Act that has come into the force in 1941. Generally, the wool is called as reclaimed, reworked, or remanufactured, or salvaged, and generally in textile industry, it is termed as shoddy. When we see that according to this Products Labeling Act, the manufacturer has to label each and every product if there is a blending that has been done. If it is pure wool, then it should be marked as pure wool only. When we say wool, it means that it is a new wool that is taken from the fleece and it has been never been used before, or it has never been spun or woven before. Now, virgin wool is another term that is comes under this act, wherein we say that it is to designate the new wool from the sheep's fleece, but now it is also including about the quality of wool, whether it is a low grade or a high grade. And if the label says it is pure wool, that means that the content of the wool should be 100% wool and never should be blended with anything else. A label called as wool blend, which means that it contains wool along with the other fibers. And we have one more called as a recycled wool. So, this recycled wool is a wool which has been remanufactured or reclaimed or unused wool materials. So, this is slightly inferior and generally goes for the lining materials for certain coats and for the jackets. Now, when we go for the physical properties of the wool, we see that when we take the structure and the composition, wool is a fiber which is creamy white in color, from light baby yellow to brown and black, and the length of the fiber would depend upon the sheep, the breeding as I have told you earlier, the type of climatic conditions under which it is being fed and the type of nutrition it is being given. It ranges from 1 to 14 inches in length and about 10 to 50 microns in diameter. And when we see the cross section, it is actually elliptical in shape with three different parts. The central part called the medulla, and the next part would be the cortex, where the cortex is supposed to be the major part in the wool which makes up about the most of the fiber. And there are two different types of cortex cells available in this, and which would behave differently, and that is the reason why we have the natural crimp in this fiber. And the last layer is supposed to be the outer layer called cuticle, where we have the scales present. This is one of the characteristic feature of wool. When we observe it under the microscope in the longitudinal section also, we can see the scales on the surface of the fiber. The more the number of scales, the more warmth it would provide, and the ends of the scales would be pointing always towards the tip of the fiber. Now, when we see the luster among all the breeds of the sheep, from where it has been taken and the conditions in which, the luster is generally varying among the animals, and not only that, it is not as lustrous as that of any synthetic fiber. This is because of the scales that are present on the surface and the rough surface it would create. And when we take the specific gravity of this wool, it is around 1.32, and under the microscope, when we see the peculiar scales are the identification. Even for a merino wool, you see lot many scales on the surface compared to the ordinary wool fibers. And when we take the strength of this fiber, it has a low degree of crystallinity and orientation, and that is the reason why this fiber is relatively weak, with a tenacity of 1 to 1.7 grams per denier. And when wet, this fiber has a peculiar characteristic of reducing its strength when wet. So, because the hydrogen bonds that are present in this fiber get broken up in the water content. So, special care needs to be exercised when this fiber is in the wet condition. When we take the elasticity of the fiber, there is a three-dimensional crimp in this fiber, which is more responsible for the elastic recovery and highly exceptional elasticity in this fiber. The wool fiber, we can consider it as a high elongation and very high elastic recovery. That means when you pull the fiber, it would elongate, and when you leave the fiber, it would come back to its original size again. The next characteristic which would depend on this is also resiliency. When you hold the fiber or the fabric in your hand and then crush it and then open the hand, it would regain its original position and the size. So, that is called as a resiliency. And in terms of resiliency, wool has an excellent resiliency quality, and that is the reason why the wrinkles are not seen on wool. Even in case there are some wrinkles, if you just hang them, maybe within few hours you can see the wrinkles will be disappearing from them. So both the elasticity of the fiber and the resiliency of the fiber are the main responsible things for the excellent appearance of the wool fiber. Now coming to the flexibility, flexibility is the bending nature of the fiber. So this fiber has a very high flexibility, and this is the reason why it is possible for production of soft fabrics with the wool fiber. And coming to the abrasion resistance, we see that it ranges from medium to low in case of apparel fabrics, and in case of the carpets that are done with the wool, we see a very high abrasion resistance also. And when we see the moisture regain, we can see that it takes around 13% to 16% of moisture under standard conditions. And it is something where we can see that it can take around 30% of its weight under saturated conditions, and in spite of this, it does not feel wet. And the scaly nature that is present on the fibers are the responsible ones which will not allow the water particles to penetrate, and it can be used when there is a light shower. It acts as a water repellency also. And the soptive character of this is very, very excellent, where though it takes up moisture, still the wearer feels very warm because of the very high heat of melting. This is a characteristic very exclusive for the woolen fiber. And coming to the dimensional stability is very poor. This is because when it is wet, you can see that the fiber loses it around 25% of its strength, and so naturally the fibers or the fabrics that are meant for apparel has to undergo a finishing process called decanting and other process for the dimensional stability. So once the finishing is being given for the dimensional stability, we can be assured that there is no further shrinkage that would happen to the fabric. Now coming to the thermal properties, wool, because of the scales, they are much warmer to wear in the cold regions, and that is the reason why sweaters are used in the colder regions. And though the yarns are very close to each other, they cannot be packed well, and that is the reason why there are air spaces that are present, and these air spaces would form as an insulative material, making the fabric warmer. And when you test the fiber, we can see that when you take it near the heat, it shrinks away, and in fact it would burn very, very slowly. And once you take it very near to the fire, it burns, but when you take it out from the fire, it is self-extinguishing. So this self-extinguishing character is the one which is required in certain flame retardancy, and so it can also be used during that conditions. And the characteristic smell that we receive from this particular burning is the burning of hair, which is very relevant for all the protein fibers. And also there is another characteristic where after burning, the fiber would be a brittle, a bead that is formed very brittle, and so a crushable one is formed, and so this is one of the characteristic that you see when wool fibers are subjected to the flame. And coming to chemical properties, alkalis will generally harm the fiber. It is susceptible to all the types of alkalis because they hydrolyze the bonds that are present in the, causing the polymers to separate. 5% sodium hydroxide solution is the one in which the wool fiber gets dissolved. And as a fact, acids generally do not harm the fiber, and in fact acid dyes are used for making or dyeing the fiber, both the protein fibers, silk and the wool. Concentrated mineral acids only like sulfuric acid and nitric acid may damage the fiber because they again hydrolyze the bonds that are present in the fiber. And when we see the bleaches, again the bleaches like chlorine bleaches and sodium hypochlorite are very, very harmful. Only hydrogen peroxide and sodium perborate are the safest bleaches that can be used for this wool. When we take the cleanliness of this fiber, wool just generally gets dirty, and the best process would be the dry cleaning. Because it loses 25% of its strength when wet, care should be exercised in seeing that it should not be beat against the stone, or it cannot be wring. It simply has to be crushed between the hands or remove the water in such a way. When the garment is to be completely cleaned, the best solution would be first take the outline of the garment on a piece of paper, then wash the fabric, and then again you stretch it to the dimensions of what has been drawn earlier, and then dry it flat. This would restore the dimensions of the particular garment, otherwise they go out of shape. And coming to the biological properties, when we take the sunlight, the effect of sunlight is something very high for the wool, where the ultraviolet radiation will tend to yellow the fiber and dull the colored fabrics and also deteriorate the fiber condition also. And mildew is something which is generally resistant to the fiber, but sometimes when it is wet and then stored away in such a condition, then mildew may develop for these particular things. And wool fabrics are damaged by the larvae because, as I told earlier, this contains sulfur in it. So the sulfide linkages is the one which is very palatable for the insects, and so they tend to eat away the fiber, and so it has to be stored in a very airtight containers. And the only bliss is that where the silverfish do not attack this particular fiber. And if it is an alkaline perspiration, perspiration also will definitely affect the fiber as that of any other alkali. And there are various ways of finishing the fiber, like fulling is make the fiber more fuller, crabbing is to set the yarn permanently, and decutting is to control the shrinkage. There is another shrinking process called the London shrinking, where it is given to high grade wool fibers to bring about a pre-shrinking process into them. And then because it is vulnerable to the moths, you can give the moth proofing treatment. To make the fuzzy surface and more loft in the fiber, we can give the napping finish, and to permanently set the dimensions of the fabric, we can give the finish of durable press also. So apart from that, now we have various types of extra or the advanced finishes that are being given to the fiber for various end uses. Now when we talk about the uses of the wool, based on the properties, the wool fabrics are used for different purposes. And when we see the majority, around 72.8% of the wool is used in apparel, it accounts for about 3.3% of wool to be used in apparel. It can be woven, it can be knitted, it can be crocheted, it can be felted also. This is one of the excellent characteristic of wool, where if moisture, pressure and alkali is given, under these conditions the scales that are present on the wool fiber would mat with each other, creating a felted fabric. So this is one of the reason why we have to be very careful when we are washing the fabric as well. Wool fabric is mostly used in the adult apparel, in coats, jackets, suits, dresses, and of different weights, because when fabric is being woven, generally they are woven in different weights, ranging from lightweight to medium weight to a very heavy weight. So all these fabrics of different weights can be woven with wool fiber. And we can see that knitted garments are the ones which are used mostly for the sportswear, because of the high elasticity of the wool as it is, and also the structure that is present in the knitted fabrics, which will make a wearer very comfortable. Suits and jackets, it gives a very tailored look. And not only that, it is also used in the household, like blankets, drapes and upholstery material, and it is also used as a material in the carpets for the warmth. As I told earlier, that blending can be done with polyester and other fibers, so these are mostly suitable for different climatic conditions. And this material is also nowadays used for a lot of insulation, where for soundproofing it can be used, and an ideal application for soundproofing is the best material these days that it can go in for. So these are some of the properties of the wool fiber. So when we go through the properties, we will find that it is a very luxurious fiber that goes into fashion apparel these days. And we can see that it undergoes lot many processes, right from the shearing to the process wherein it can be separated into two different types of fibers, like the woolen and the worsted, each of which having a different end use. And not only that, it has come into a usage wherein now we have a separate range of textiles called the technical textiles, which wool is also supposed to be used in the form of a technical textile, which is finding its major use in technical textiles also.